stand, and then we're going to start.
He did not need it. Ta-da.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Raise your hand if you hear me. Good. Good job. It's good to see everybody. This is a nice bunch of people who decided to answer that alarm and get up and go somewhere this morning. Good for you. Stand up and praise the Lord with us this morning.
Father God, as we come before you today, Father, we worship you. Father, we honor you. And Father, I thank you for each of my brothers and sisters that have made the decision to give this hour to you in worship and in praise. Father, bottom line is we just love you and we worship you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
You may have a seat this morning, and I think I've been told couple different things here, and I don't want to make a mistake here, but you can have a seat. And I think before the kids come up, I want to introduce Reverend Jim Hancock. He is the pastor of Trinity Church in
Olive Branch,
Mississippi, correct? It's not Mississippi, it's Mississippi. And Brother Jim is also, he's a high official. He's a head honcho of the Congregational Methodist Church. Brother Jim.
Thank you, brother. Yeah. And here's what that means by being a head honcho. We don't have head honchos. So I'm just one of us. Amen. That's all that matters. So this will be the first time ever I've done this this way. But for lots of different reasons, we're flexible. The president of our denomination has this term that he likes to use. He said, "Blessed are the flexible." So in this case, we at the conference yesterday, we performed the business side of the necessity of asking questions and making sure that everything was done to extend elder credentials to your pastor. That was finished yesterday, but when we started the giving certain things out and doing a couple of different prayers, I asked him to step out, and I thought he might have thought that was the shortest elder we've ever had. I don't know what he was thinking, but this morning I want to complete a few things specific for him because this is his church. You are his family, and he also has some family here, and I just wanted to do these next parts for him specifically in the church, knowing that I would be here this morning. So, brother, would you come up and join me? And you got to step up to this one for this. So, Gene Bacchus has been duly recognized by the North Central Annual Conference of the Congregational Methodist Church to the order of elder in the Church of God, and I present him to you right now for the completion of his ordination. Matthew chapter 28 says, "And Jesus spoke to them, saying, All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." This is a command that for all Christians, but especially for those who have been called to the ministry. And this is a command with a promise that as we go forth to disciple and baptize and to teach, we will know the presence of Christ even to the end. This promise is to you because you love God and you have answered His call. God has poured out His Spirit upon you. This is His gift to you. Don't be negligent in the use of these gifts. And may your every endeavor be to equip the saints, to build up the body of Christ, His church, to the unity of the faith, and in gaining knowledge of Jesus, God's Son, so that you may be complete in all things to the glory of God. Let us pray. Almighty God, giver of every good and perfect gift, mercifully behold this thy servant, now set apart for the office of and work of elder in thy church. Grant so to replenish him with the truth of thy doctrine and adorn him with the innocence of life that both by word and good example he may faithfully serve the church in this office to the glory of thy name and the edification of thy people through the merits of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Eugene Bacchus, you have the affirmation of the people of Jesus Christ. Let's give him a round. So by the Spirit of God, you are recognized as a servant in the ministry of Jesus Christ, His church. Gene, I could say Reverend Gene now. Reverend Gene. We present this Bible to you in recognition of the foundation upon which your ministry is built upon. So live that the word is near you, on your lips, and in your heart. I present you with this certificate of ordination. May it be a sign of your authority, your fellowship with all who serve in this office of ministry, and your purpose and your promise to uphold this sacred calling. Remember, it was the Savior who said, "But he who is greatest among you shall be your servant." You may have to grow another arm here in just a minute, but that's okay. Yeah, would you? Come on. I also present you with this book of discipline, that your commitment to the Congregational Methodist Church, its doctrinal precepts, its high standard of ethic, and its representative governmental principles may be in whole and not in part. There's no single one of these items that's more important than the other except for the Bible. But there's one thing here that I want to present to you, and this is a pastor's towel. And it's, there you go, I'm going to hand that to you that way. This towel is symbolic to remind you that Jesus has called you to be a servant in His kingdom, just as Jesus used a towel when He washed the disciples' feet as a servant. May that. Thank you. Now, what he doesn't know is this, that I've got to get this microphone and hand it to you, because I'm going to give you a chance to speak a couple of words. I'm not going to give you a time. I'm not going to give you a time limit like you gave me earlier, but that's also why she's here to nudge you. So, please.
You all know that I accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior at age 16. I preached my first sermon at age 18. I've been involved in ministry ever since. It was December of 2005 when God called me to pastoral ministry. And it was Father's Day of 2006 that I preached my first sermon here at St. James West. And God has called me to be a servant. To be a servant. And I pray that in all of my actions, that humility of service has shined forth, because I do believe that we are called to be a servant. And Pastor Joe Holland gave me the greatest advice. He said, "Gene, you only have to do two things: preach the word and love the people." And that has always been my motto, to preach the word and love the people. I thank you.
From Numbers chapter 6, says, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance on you and give you peace. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, brother. Thank you.
Please be seated. Kids, down front, please. Kids, down front. John, I need your help. Come here, buddy. If you'd give every kid a palm. Every kid needs a palm branch this morning. And John's bigger than me, so you got to do what he says. Every kid needs a palm branch. Every kid. Now, why are you getting a palm branch? What is today? Today is Palm Sunday, which means what? It is 1 week before Easter. Yep. And you saw the Easter bunny? Yes. I love it. I saw the Easter bunny at my house, too. He's all in chocolate in my refrigerator. That's a different Easter bunny. But, guys, this is Palm Sunday. Yes, 1 week before Easter. And what is Easter? What is Easter? Kids, talk to me. What is Easter? Jesus, say that again, Addie. Say it again.
Rose from the dead.
He rose from the dead. Yes. So he rose from the dead. Yes. So today, we're going to walk around the church. Okay. Who's going to be the leader of the band that plays for me and you? M-I-C-K-E-Y. Will you be the leader? All right, here's what you're going to do right up here. And you're going to walk down the aisle. You're going to take a left, come down this aisle, come back, go back down the aisle, and come back around, and come right back up here, okay? And there, tell everybody, turn around, tell everybody your name. Jonathan. So Jonathan's the leader of the band that plays for me and you.
You and me.
All right, so you guys are going to follow Jonathan. I want you to hold your... Hey, do I know what? What's your name?
My name is Jordan.
Billy Bob?
No, my name is Jordan.
Fred?
Jordan.
Jeffrey J?
No, Jordan.
Jordan who?
That's my name.
Oh, Jordan. All right, so you're going to wave your palm branches. And are we singing?
We're singing, so all of you get to sing.
So everybody gets to sing, and you're going to wave your palm branches, which is what happened on... Hi, I didn't see you earlier. So you're good. So we're going to sing, and we're going to wave the palm branches, which is what happened 1 week before Easter. Okay? So everybody's going to follow. We're going to sing. Here we go.
Turn to you. when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Got a question for you. We sang Hosanna. What does Hosanna mean? Nobody knows what Hosanna means?
Nope.
Let's ask everybody else. Let's turn it around. What's Hosanna mean? God save us. God save us. All right? So, all right. Now, here's what I'm going to ask that you do. I'm going to ask that you put your palm branches right back here because we're going to use those, okay? We save those and we use them again on Ash Wednesday. And you guys ready to head upstairs?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Everybody say yes.
Yes.
I didn't hear you.
Yes.
Yes. I'm blind and deaf. You got to say it louder. Yes. All right, you can head upstairs, guys. Great job today. Oh, okay.
Wow, now it's my turn.
Yeah.
Holy cow.
Thank you, guys.
Okay.
Good job. Thank you, sir. You're a gentleman and a scholar. All right. Couple of announcements. Next Sunday, Easter. Believe it or not, we're having Easter breakfast on Easter. Next Sunday, 8 a.m. There's a sign up in the back. If you'd like to come to Easter breakfast, please sign up so we make sure we have enough food. This week is Holy Week. Monday, Thursday, 7 p.m. We will celebrate Holy Communion and remember the events of Monday, Thursday of Jesus with the disciples in the upper room. Friday, 7 p.m., Good Friday service. And I've always said, the most difficult service for me to serve in on Good Friday. It's just such a difficult service on Good Friday. But that's Friday at 7 p.m., Sunday, breakfast at 8, services at 9 and 10:30. Also in the back, there's a sign up if you want to help serve breakfast at the United Caring Shelter. We do that the second Saturday of each month. You can sign up. I think there's another sign up back there, but I don't remember what it is.
Prayer Warrior.
Prayer Warriors. We have a ministry in the church called Prayer Warriors. It's just a volunteer position. Depending on how many we have, you just rotate whenever it's your Sunday. And you come in a few minutes early, you pray over the pews and those that are going to be sitting in those pews for that service, and you pray with me before the service. If we have 10 people, you do it every 10 weeks. If we have 20 people, you do it every 20 weeks. But if you're interested in being a prayer warrior, you can sign up in the back, or you can talk to Johnny West. Rumor has it that Johnny charges $10 a minute.
So I
don't know if that's true or not. We'll see if he has a new truck next week. But if you'd like to, if you're interested in being a prayer warrior, you can talk to Johnny. He heads that up and find out a little bit more about it. Any other announcements this week? Nope. Okay. As we meet and greet, you've already met Brother Jim Hancock, not from Mississippi, but from Missouri. If you get a chance, there are a few other people here today that I think have not been here before. So make sure you introduce yourself to them and give them a George Washington, okay? Meet and greet, 38 seconds, ready, go.
Messiah.
Lord of all. His body the bread, his blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all our hope is in you. All our hope is in you. All the glory to you, God, the light of the Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah, Lord of all. Jesus Messiah, you are Lord of all.
Amen. You may be seated.
Oh. This next song, and I know I mentioned this to you guys a few months ago, but the next song is the Revelation song. And it has really, I just don't know how you sing them without truly being transported right before Jesus and singing to him. But my brain, being what it is, when I read Revelation song, I thought, I guess it's a revelation. I thought, well, that's kind of cool. And then Aaron Taylor pointed out and reminded me that it is straight from the book of Revelation. Everything in it is scripture. So please, 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 when you sing this song, don't just go, oh, those are nice words. That sounded good. It had a great message. No, please know that you are singing the word of God.
Sing a new song to him. Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed in rainbow, living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, I will adore you. Of your name, Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Watching, I thought we were going to do one more song, but I think they cut a song out to give Brother Jim a little more time to preach. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. As we go to the Lord in prayer before Jim preaches, ask your prayers. Shirley Dill's been in the hospital this week. She is at home, but I certainly ask your prayers for Shirley Dill. Lisa Myers, her mother, Barbara, is in the final stages of her life. She is up in Ferdinand, Indiana, and Lisa and her daughter Amber, and I'm not sure who else in the family is up in Ferdinand, but I ask your prayers for Lisa Myers' mother, Barbara, and the family during this time. Also, as you noticed, Kim is not here on the piano today. Kim and her family are in Florida on the beach. And that, if you know the story of Matt Cameron, that is a miracle. But I ask your prayers for them as they are traveling. Rick is not here. He and his family are also in Florida. Something about going to Florida on spring break. And I know there are other families in our church that are traveling this week. If you have a prayer or praise, if you lift it up today. Father God, we come before you. Father, we do thank you. Father, we honor you. And Father, because we love you, Father, we serve you. And Father, we call your Son not only our Savior and our Redeemer, but our Lord. And we thank you for your gift of your Son. And as we consider the events of this week, oh, Father, the events of this week of Jesus in the upper room with his disciples instituting what we refer to as Holy Communion and his arrest and betrayal and conviction and the events of Good Friday, his death on the cross, and how the veil was torn in two, and Father, the agony, the confusion of Saturday, and the glory of Resurrection Sunday. Father, we do give you thanks and praise. We ask your loving arms on those that are dealing with broken bodies, broken hearts, broken spirits, broken relationships. Father, love on them today. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. I have invited Brother Jim to bring the message this morning. And as I mentioned, he is the pastor of Trinity Church and I'm trying to say it your way, but it's Mississippi. Brother Jim has lived in Mississippi. He's lived in Nashville, Tennessee, Phoenix, Arizona, Boston, Massachusetts, for some reason, Nashville, Tennessee. And currently, he's back home in, is it Baldwin?
Baldwin.
Back home. Yes. And I've invited Brother Jim to bring the message today.
Thank you, Brother. Good morning. Once again, as I mentioned earlier, I just wanted to say how honored I am to be here. And how thankful I am that your church was such a magnificent host for our North Central Annual Conference yesterday. I want to thank y'all for just your participation and your volunteering to help out with that. And I do want to make one mention. I'm not sure how fair Pastor Gene is, but apparently, he's not showing that fairness to me. When he told me that I was going to preach two sermons, I didn't know he preached the same sermon twice. I had two completely different sermons for today. So if some of you were at the earlier service and came back to see where I messed up on the first one, I'm not even going to be in the same, I'm not even going to be in the same testament. I'm going to be in the Old Testament today. So that's just the way it works out. But I also want to mention, I loved seeing the kids that were participating in things and learning along the way what the meaning of different things are, the meaning of the palm branches and the meaning of Hosanna. Reminded me actually of a story of a little boy. He grew up in church and he got to that point that he was coming into the sanctuary for worship and had been out with the children's church for a while, and he was right at that age, and every little thing that was going on, he would ask his dad, "Dad, what does that mean, and what does that mean?" So they it was happened to be that particular Sunday that they were doing communion. And they were in that particular church, they were passing out the bread and the juice. And he had asked his dad, he looked and he saw the bread going by, and he said, Daddy, what does that mean? And he said, well, son, that represents the body of Christ that was broken for you and for us. And then the juice came by, and he said, Daddy, what does that mean? And he said, he said, that means that just represents the blood of Christ that was poured out. And then right after the Lord's Supper, the pastor started to preach, and he took off his watch, and he put that watch right there on the pulpit, right where it could be seen. He said, Daddy, what does that mean? He said, absolutely nothing. Folks, I want to share a story with you out of the Old Testament. It's going to come out of the book of 1 Kings. You can find that in your Bibles if you will. Something about God's voice. And my prayer for you before you leave today, my prayer has been this past week, that you will hear His voice. And what that means for you in your life. Someone once said that sometimes the Lord calms the storm, sometimes He lets the storm rage and calms the child. There's a great deal of truth in that statement. Very often, what we really need is just to be quiet before the Lord so that we can hear Him speak the words that will calm our fears and calm our life. You know, before refrigerators, which was definitely before my time, but before refrigerators were out, people used ice houses to preserve their food. And these ice houses had these real thick walls in them, and they had no windows, they had a really tight fitted door, so everything was completely airtight. And in the winter, when the streams or the lakes were frozen over, these large blocks of ice were cut out and brought to the ice house and hauled there, and they were covered with sawdust to keep it from melting. And a lot of times that ice would last well into the summer in those ice houses. One day this man lost a very valuable watch to him while he was working in that ice house. And he searched for it over and over and over. He couldn't find it. And he raked through the sawdust and he just didn't find it. Other people that were working there tried to help him look for it, but they just couldn't. It was just futile. But this little boy, he heard about this fruitless search. he slipped into the ice house while everybody was at lunch about around noon. And right after that, soon after that, he came out holding that watch. And the men saw that he did, and they were just amazed, and they asked him, they said, how did you find that? And he said, well, just simply this. I laid down in the sawdust, and I kept very still, and suddenly I heard that watch ticking. See, oftentimes the question is not whether God is speaking, but whether we're still enough, we're quiet enough to hear Him. At different times in our lives, and maybe right now you are dealing with one of those times in your life. We face situations, we face difficulty in our lives, and things that even provoke fear in us, and our circumstances that are going on, and everything in life is so noisy around us. We've got to remember that the Lord is not far from us. The Lord is with us. He will never fail to guide us along. If you found your scriptures, 1 Kings chapter 19, would you please stand for the reading of God's Word? 1 Kings chapter 19, we're going to read through verse 9 to start this morning. Our dear Heavenly Father, Lord, speak to us. Calm us so we can hear you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. 1 Kings 19, starting in verse 1. Now Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, "So may the gods do to me and even more if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." And he was afraid and rose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat under a juniper tree. He requested for himself that he might die and said, "It is enough now, O Lord, take my life, for I am not better than my father's." He lay down and slept under a juniper tree, and behold, there was an angel touching him. And he said to him, "Arise, eat." Then he looked, and behold, there was at his head a bread cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, "Arise, eat, because the journey is too great for you." So he arose and ate and drank and went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mountain of God. Then he came there to a cave and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" You may be seated. The word of God is for the people of God. Thank you, God. What are you doing here, Elijah? I almost want to ask the question and maybe even change the title of this message today instead of the calm of his voice of saying, "What are you doing here? What are you doing here?" Because that's how this ended, was asking that question. You know, sometimes we feel alone in this world. I mentioned earlier in the message, talking about that we feel alone, that we feel that we are being attacked in this world, and that sometimes standing for God, it just makes us sometimes feel that we are just alone. And we see here in this scripture where Elijah was kind of taking refuge under a broom tree, a juniper tree, which basically another word for it is a broom tree. And he just prayed for his death. Elijah, the mighty prophet, he stood for God as boldly as anybody would. Yet there he was, alone, seemingly to him, deserted. Seemingly that he was deserted in this wasteland, in this wilderness, the very symbol of a wasted life. Yet God would tenderly nourish him. He would nourish him and he would lead Elijah to a place where he would get some instruction that he needed. You know, life can feel that way sometimes for us. Life can feel that way that we sometimes might even feel like our actions don't really make any difference at all. That living a marked life, as I was speaking about earlier. But in Jesus, I'll tell you right now, there is more hope. There's so much hope and power, just like that Revelation song talks about, which is straight out of Scripture. There's so much power and there's so much hope in our situation. Yes, even that situation that you think right now there's no hope in. Folks, there's always hope in Jesus. Amen? There's always going to be hope. There always has been and there always will be. I'll tell you right now, when we feel that we have nothing, just nothing that we do that matters anymore in this world, folks, we need to pause. We need to be quiet. We need to listen for God. So I want to ask you, what voices are you listening to? I don't know about y'all, but even in Mississippi, a month or two ago, it was really, really cold. Did it get cold up here too? We had 5 days straight that the temperature did not get out of the 20s, and we had 8 inches of snow and ice on the ground. And that's a lot for Mississippi, a whole lot, because we don't have those things that I remember in Boston called snow plows. Apparently back in the 60s, they bought a bunch of snow plows, and they sat and rusted because they were never used, so they didn't buy anymore. So we just have to wait for it to pretty much melt on its own. But I remember how cold it was. There were these friends, Jake and Mark. They decided to go ice fishing. We talked a lot about fishing yesterday in various ways. But they decided to go out and do some ice fishing. That's one of the things that my wife talks about so much. Her dad used to take, he was crazy. He would take the shed, this little rickety shed, and put it on skis and take it out in the middle of a lake during the winter. And go inside that thing and light a fire and then cut a hole and fish. And then hopefully they'd get it back before the thaw, because that's why I was on the skis. And I'm sure there's going to be a lot of those little houses that are at the bottom of those lakes because they didn't get it back in time. So she knows all about ice fishing. Well, I heard that story about the story about Jake and Mark, and they decided to go ice fishing one day. They head out, they find this great little spot, and they cut a hole in the ice, and they stick in their poles to go fishing, and suddenly there's this loud voice from above saying, "There are no fish there." Jake and Mark kind of looked at each other. They didn't know what this loud voice was, and they said, "Well, I suppose we better move on then." Well, they did, and they get up, they find another spot, nice flat spot, and they cut a hole, and they stick their fishing poles in down there in the hopes of these fresh fish to come out. And once again, that loud voice comes booming from above and said, "There are no fish here." They kind of look around, look up at each other, and say, "Well, we best try again and find one more spot." And so they gather up everything they've got, and they do again, and they cut another hole, put the fish in. Once again, that big loud voice, "There are no fish here." They look around, and Mark looks at Jake, and he says, "God in heaven, is that you?" The voice said, "Nope, this is the skating rink manager. There are no fish here." See, I believe when we hear God's voice, we actually will know it. I believe we'll know it, but we have to be quiet to hear it. Because I believe that sometimes we do everything that we can in our lives. We try everything possible. If we can't Google it and figure it out, then we give up. But you know, when all of our strength is gone, and again, you've probably been there, or you're there right now. When everything is just seems at the end, just like Elijah did. Elijah went and said, "Just end it all now, Lord. There's no hope." Just sat and felt sorry for himself. We've done it, haven't we? We've sat around and felt sorry for ourselves before. But the Lord did something with Elijah. He called Elijah aside and helped him regain his focus. See, he needed that physical and that spiritual strength. And God was going to help him find it. God was going to help him find it. See, God speaks to us when our purpose is lost. when we feel our purpose is lost. Because it wasn't long after he arrived at Mount Sinai that he heard that voice of God. But instead of just giving him instructions and or sympathy, the Lord just asked him a question, what probably felt to Elijah about the most ridiculous question you could ask. What are you doing here, Elijah? This is the Lord asking Elijah. See, I can almost sense Elijah's attitude here. You know, it's almost like Elijah, if I were him, if I were Elijah, I would have said, well, Lord, in case you've missed it, you know, I'm running for my life, Lord. I've had it with rejection. I've had it with danger. And I've had it with your people. That's basically what he was saying. But God knew why he was there. God knew why he was there. After all, the Lord led him there. But God wanted Elijah to do some soul searching. Have you ever wondered in the book of Genesis when Adam and Eve had committed the first sin? And what did God say? Where are you, Adam? Don't you know there were only two people on the earth? God knew where they were. So why did he ask the question? Where are you? He wanted Adam to admit where he was. It wasn't because God didn't know where he was. This is why he asked that question there in verse 9 of Elijah. Elijah, what are you doing here? It wasn't because he didn't know what he was doing there. He wanted Elijah to do some soul searching. Because I tell you, when the road ahead of us seems unclear, you know, God doesn't always clarify His will in an obvious manner. Look at verse 10 and 11. He said, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the son of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. In verse 11, so he said, go forth and stand on the mountain before the Lord, and behold, the Lord was passing by. And a great and strong wind was rending the mountains and breaking in pieces the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. I'll get to the second part of that verse here in just a moment. Oh, I just wonder. I just wonder sometimes when we think all the things that are going on around us and we're searching for God's voice and all the noise and all the destruction and everything that's going on around us. What does God mean by all that? Well, here's an example of all those things are taking place. But it says the Lord was not in those things. But then in the second part of verse 12, it says, and after the fire, a sound of a gentle blowing. When Elijah heard it, meaning that gentle blowing, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. And behold, a voice came to him and said, what are you doing here, Elijah? You notice he asked that question twice. See, when he asked that question earlier, Elijah couldn't hear him because of everything else going on and the lack of soul searching. And then what did God do? God didn't calm him. No, he sent there were earthquakes and the fire and the winds and all these things, and still he didn't hear him. But as soon as that calm voice, that gentle wind, then God asked the same question, what are you doing here, Elijah? Then he said, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the son of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away. But we look and notice what took place. It says, the Lord passed by, but was not in the wind, was not in the earthquake, was not in the fire. But finally, there was that small voice, that gentle voice. And then there's the message. What are you doing here, Elijah? Again, I can think Elijah even at that point. That's it, God? You're just asking me the same question again? I come all this way. I've been through all of this. Everything I've been through, all the extraordinary displays of power, and all I get is that question again. What am I doing here? God, I thought we had that covered. See, God's heavenly will doesn't always make earthly sense. God's heavenly will does not always make earthly sense. The truth about the situation according to Elijah was, your people have torn down, your people have forsaken, your people have killed, your people are now looking for me, and now my life is in danger. See, Elijah actually said the same thing to God one chapter before in chapter 18. In verse 4, he says, I'm the only one left that wants to serve you. Have you ever faced a situation where you just don't know what to do? I see this. I love the stained glass windows here in the church. And I heard the story. I won't get into it now, but I will share the story about even these up here in the what's now the front of the church. I see this particular one over here with Jesus and the sheep. I learned something after many years about sheep and studying sheep. That maybe there's one person here that doesn't know this. It may be that almost everybody knows it, and that's okay. That's a good reminder. There's something about sheep. There's something about Jesus tending the sheep that's important for us to know. Sheep are not by design, they cannot carry any weight or loads whatsoever. If you put any kind of heavy weight on a sheep, they will fall down, collapse, and actually, if they collapse in a particular way, they cannot get back up without somebody picking them up and putting them back on their feet. And they'll lay there and just die. Sheep are not designed to bear the weight. We are like sheep, folks. We are not designed to bear the weight of this world, the weight of our troubles, the earthquakes of our lives, the fires of our lives, the storms of our lives. We are not designed to bear that, but there's somebody who is. It's called Jesus Christ. That's why we have the great shepherd. If you feel weighted down, if you feel that the burdens of this life are just so great that you just can't get through, folks, God sent His Son. His name is Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. See, He came to take those burdens off of your shoulders. He came to make sure that you did not have to bear them, because He already knows. He created you. He knows you cannot bear the weight. Isaiah 30:21 says, and whenever you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear this command behind you. This is the way. Walk in it. This is the way. Walk in it. I have that image of a shepherd with sheep. And the shepherd is guiding those sheep down where they're supposed to go. And those sheep want to go to the right or to the left. But the shepherd is giving them a command from behind them, showing them and telling them what direction to go. That's why I feel like that verse in Isaiah 30 says, the voice is from behind you saying, this is the way, walk in it. It's almost as if you could close your eyes and hear that voice. God will speak to us if we will get alone with Him and tune out the rest of the world and all of the other voices. I want to share a story and just to close here. I want to share a quick story with you. It has a little bit to do, kind of, sort of, with my upbringing and where I've been. I grew up in Mississippi. Where I live right now was my grandparents' home. If anybody wants to follow me, and if you're interested in fishing, come on. We've got 300 acres, 5 lakes. One neighbor, dead end road. Come on, I'm ready to go. And I don't fish, actually. So it's a shame. But there's something about living in a place like that that you learn to appreciate certain things. And being in Boston, I worked downtown Boston every day. It's very different. I enjoyed it very much, but it's different. Reminds me of this story about these two friends. They were both raised in a place kind of like where I live right now. And one stayed there all of his life. And one decided to move to New York. I won't use Boston because my wife will get mad because that's where she's from. But he decided, the other friend decided to move to New York. Well, the friend from the country decided to go up and visit the city friend. And he got up there, and they were walking along the sidewalks, and of course everything is just so noisy, and the horns were blowing, and sirens going off, and people, it was just, you know, it's New York City. That's what you're going to get. And the country friend was walking next to him, and he said, "Do you hear that?" And the guy that's in the city now, he says, "What are you talking about?" And the country friend said, "Do you not hear that? I hear crickets." Now the city friend said, "Now listen, you don't hear crickets. You're not hearing crickets. You're, he said, "No, I am. I'm telling you, I am." And the city friend stopped. And there was one of those little trees growing out of one of those grapes on the sidewalk with a little planter around it. And he said, "Stop, I'm telling you, I hear crickets." So he stopped real carefully and listened real attentively to try to tune out everything else going on. And sure enough, there was a cricket in that planter. I was just making cricket noises. See, the difference is that friend that was from the country knew what to listen for, knew, recognized the sounds of the crickets, that even when he was then in a place that was unfamiliar with him, he still heard those crickets. I wonder sometimes with us. I wonder sometimes with us in this life. We know the voice of God. It's what brought us to Jesus. We know all of this. But maybe we have been distracted by all the other noises that have been going on for years, decades, maybe just weeks and months. All these other noises are going on, and we have forgotten what it's like to just listen to God's voice. Just listen to His voice and hear Him speak. Not that He's going to bang out a message to you in a real loud voice saying, "Do this," But he's going to do something like he did with Elijah. He's going to nourish you. He's going to give you instruction. He's going to teach you. And then when you go out on your way, you can go out on your way in the same noise that's out there, but be filled with him, with the knowledge of him, and not have any fear in whatever you might have to face. His voice does things. It comforts us. It challenges us. It guides us like the shepherd. And it reassures us. But one of the other things that it does is it makes his presence known to you. Folks, God is with us in this place right now. But he's also with you when you leave this place. Are you hearing his voice? How long has it been since you truly just heard his voice? That you've taken some time and just let him speak to you? You're going to have that opportunity right now. I'm going to ask you to stand. Here in this next few moments, I'm going to have a word of prayer with you. And then I'm going to invite you to listen for God's voice. And some of you, it may be that for you to listen to God's voice, that these altars, which is a wonderful place to be, will be a place that you need to come and kneel and listen to Him. Like that little boy that was going down into that sawdust, listening for that watch ticking so he could find what the other man had been looking for. How long has it been since you have purposefully stopped and listened for his voice? He's ready to guide, he's ready to comfort, he's ready to nourish, and he's ready to instruct. If you'll listen. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord. Lord, we thank you for being here. We thank you for sending your Son to ultimately die on the cross for our sins, but also to ultimately be raised from the dead, and that through him we can have eternal salvation in only him. Lord, there are some here that have forgotten what your voice sounds like. There are some here that maybe have never stopped everything going on in their lives and just listened for your voice. I pray, Lord, that in this next few moments, that they'll take time to stop and listen to you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Brother Gene's going to be up the front here to receive you, to pray with you over something. And I'd like to invite you, can we have something just playing, like a guitar, anything at all? Anything, whatever you want. And these altars are open for you to come and pray. This is between you and the Lord. It's not between you and this church and Pastor Gene or anybody else. This is just between you and the Lord. Take this time. Would you come? Thank you.
God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your spirit. And Father, we thank you that we have the privilege of worshiping together the body of Christ. And Father, we thank you that these four walls can be turned into a sanctuary, into the very presence of God. And Father, we give you thanks and praise on this day. Father, I pray your blessing upon your people. And Father, may we truly, like Elijah, sit down and listen for your voice, because you do speak to us, Father. You whisper to us. And Father, we give you thanks and praise on this day. In Jesus' name, amen.